asking for, thank you, for 10 second moment of silence to remember the 2 million Afghans who have been killed in the past 35 years of war, and around 4,000 soldiers, U.S. soldiers, that were killed in the war in Afghanistan.
And everybody in my
Afghan community in the Bay Area, which is the largest Afghan community in the United States. And even one of my family members were imprisoned for suspectful activities. Muslims were asked not to gather in large groups nor attend Friday prayers. All of a sudden, my very segregated life came crashing together. And I spent the next few years trying to figure out, where do I belong? Am I Afghan? Am I American? Can those two coexist together? So that's how I ended up on that airplane going to Afghanistan with three of my colleagues. Before getting on the airplane, I warned my colleagues. I said, don't rely on me for any cultural input. I have no idea anything about this country. My language skills are terrible, but it's better than yours, so you're happy to rely on me. I told them that I'm going to be so emotional. I'm going to see my aunt and my cousins, and I'm going to burst into tears. So you guys have to just deal with that. And I warned them that people probably hate me for, you know, being an Afghan, a fake Afghan, and that they'll just have to be there for me to cry on their shoulders. So I armed myself with several packets of Kleenex and got off that airplane in Kabul. And lo and behold, as soon as I breathed in the fresh air and heard Dari spoken and looked at the Hindu Kush Mountains, which you actually can see from the airport, I felt completely at home. Afghans were so nice. They were, welcome back, it's so great to have you. I was, chatting with men, my headscarves kept falling off because nobody seemed to care. That Afghan women were so thankful that I'd come to check on them. And my family members and friends and relatives told me all their stories of the horrible years that they had passed. And I was so strong, I didn't shed a single tear. So on my way back to the United States, we decided to take one day decompression in Dubai. And I was like, wow, that was so amazing. I mean, I didn't cry, I wasn't insulted, nobody thought I was a fake Afghan, they all said that I spoke such great English. This was a successful trip. And so the next day in Dubai, I went to the gluttonous breakfast buffet and stuffed myself with all kinds of good food that I couldn't have for 10 days. And I don't know how, but I somehow stuffed myself in a bathing suit and went to the 10th floor of my hotel and sat by the infinity pool. And, you know, I was very happy with my success in my trip. So I decided, well, I should write down what happened. I mean, I need to retell the story. And before I could write out a word down, all of a sudden this deep welling started brewing down here, and it slowly moved up and up and up, and tears, I mean waterfalls of tears were coming out of my eyes. So I put on the dark sunglasses and tried to hide what I was feeling. I was like keeping my eyes shut and going, go away, I don't want to feel you. And as my eyes were closed, I saw the sad face of the five-year-old counselor and the hopeless eyes of the man that they lit sitting on the side of Kabul Road. And I saw the face of the Afghan minister, female minister, who was my host, and she was always in meetings like this with men, whereas the men would listen to me and talk to me and they would completely ignore her. I saw the realities of when we were traveling from Kabul to Ghazni, and that was put there by the U.S. military, and the helicopter were flying overhead, and they were coming down on the car, and U.S. military personnel were looking with their dark Terminator sunglasses inside our car and searching the trunks of our car for weapons and such. And I thought about, this is what Afghans have to live with every day. And I realized that I had seen everything through my American filter. And all of a sudden, I realized, wow, when I was talking to those men and they were just chatting with me, well, they really saw me as a third gender. The norms of what Afghan women are expected to did not apply to me. But that doesn't mean that it didn't exist. And then I realized that they really didn't see me as an Afghan. They saw me just like all the other aid workers who flooded Afghanistan. And they came and asked questions, took pictures, made promises, and they never returned. And the reason I could go wherever I wanted to and say what I wanted to was because they didn't take me seriously. I was just a passerby. So I had another cry because I felt so foolish and ridiculous for thinking that I had made such a successful journey and that I had connected with my people. But somehow that knowledge shifted something inside me. And in the next 24 hours, which is how long it took to get back home, my husband and I were standing by the luggage carousel in the San Francisco airport. And I turned to him and I said, I belong here with you and our kids and on the hilly streets of San Francisco. And I also discovered I belong there on the dirt roads of Kabul and the peaks of Hidden Kush Mountains. And I realized that I don't have to choose between being an Afghan or an American. I was an Afghan American. And now I'm going to go on script by reading to you a postscript of what has happened since 2006. Well, the female minister who stood, you know, with her heads down and her shoulders rolled, well, she lost her job just a few months after we left because a man was put in her place and she did not offer anything else. So she contacted me and we partnered with her, with Afghan Friends Network. And together, we've dedicated our work by educating girls, boys, and women in Afghanistan. We've raised $500,000 in the past 12 years. We've educated 4,300 girls. We've provided literacy classes for 250 women. We've taught English to 750 boys and trained 450 male and female teachers. 22 girls and 6 boys have received scholarship and have gone to university due to the work that we do. And we currently employ 21 Afghans. So I hope that in the next 12 years, the works that we've done in the past 12 years will make us extinct and that Afghans will not need our help anymore. And as for me, well, I've gone from knowing nothing about Afghanistan to becoming an activist for Afghan people and Afghan women. I've become an advocate and a voice for Afghans, and I spend a great deal of my time trying to bridge the gap of cultural misunderstanding between Americans and Afghans. I work as a consultant with authors, playwrights, film, and theater production teams to authentically portray Afghan people, because that is one of the areas that we can have a big misunderstanding between people. And I write food and culture. nice journal habit to share with you or that follow your both in women. So I wanted to leave you with a quote from the poet Rumi, who was originally from Afghanistan, and he said, "Don't be satisfied with stories and how things have gone with others. Unfold your own myth." Thank you.